So we're going to move away from the idea that the Earth is just a ball covered with ocean now and look at real oceans with real coastlines. And this is the kind of map that you draw. So the blue lines are amplitude and the red lines are phase, right? And what we have is maximum amplitudes are close to the coasts, generally speaking. And then you do have these points where the amplitude is zero. Now, this map has been drawn for the semi-diurnal lunar component, right? The M2 tide. You have to draw a different map for every component of the tide. So you look at the variations at this exact frequency, and this is the pattern that you get. So maximum amplitudes are near the coasts. There are regions where the amplitude is zero, where these red phase lines come together, right? So here, in the North Atlantic here, there's no tide. Here on the coast, you have the maximum amplitude, and it will obviously vary during the day on a 12-hour, 25-minute period. And so that maximum will be seen at different times of day. So here's zero, 2 hours later, 4 hours later, five, six, seven, eight, all the way around to 12 hours. It propagates round, okay? And you can see it's going round anti-clockwise around this nodal point. So this is called the amphidromic system, and this is an amphidromic node here. And so you have the tide circulating around that node on the tidal period with its maximum amplitude, usually near the coast. Here's another one going around this way. Here you've got one, two, three, four, also going around this way. Here's one where it goes around the other way, right? Here as well, it's going around clockwise. So where is it going around anticlockwise and where is it going around clockwise? Well, it depends on the exact shape of the coasts and the arrangements of the ocean basins, but a simple-minded explanation would be that in the northern hemisphere it goes anticlockwise and in the southern hemisphere it goes clockwise. There are exceptions to that, though. So why would that be? Why would the phase propagate around a nodal point anticlockwise here but clockwise here, right? Well, let's just stick with the northern hemisphere. Why is it going around anticlockwise? Does it remind you of anything? Does it remind you of anything from the course, which when we were talking about wave dynamics? We studied a wave called a Kelvin wave, didn't we, which is trapped on the coast. Yeah? And we said that in the northern hemisphere, that Kelvin wave propagates with the coast to the right. And that's exactly what's happening here. The tide propagates around the coast as a Kelvin wave. It's just a gravity wave propagating around a coast. It's a gravity wave that has been forced by gravitational force. It's propagating around the coast. It is a Kelvin wave, right? So here's another way to explain why a Kelvin wave propagates in that way. Let's imagine that we're forcing the water into this closed basin here, right? So the water comes rushing in, and as it moves into the basin, because it's been attracted there by the moon, right, it experiences the Coriolis force, which pushes it to the right. So it piles up on the right-hand coast here, right? And then 6 hours later, it gets pulled out again by the tidal attraction, right? And as it comes out, again, it's pushed to the right by the Coriolis force. So it'll pile up against the opposite wall. So in the process of a tidal cycle, it has gone around the basin like that, okay? Around these phase lines like that. Anticlockwise, just like a Kelvin wave, because that's what it is. Now, here are a few examples of tides of different frequencies. We have the thing we saw at the beginning, comes from somewhere in England, where there's a very clear semi-diurnal tide, right? So we have two tides per day, and we have modulation with every 15 days we have a peak in the tidal amplitude. Right? Here's San Francisco. Now there you have, sometimes it looks like there's semi-diurnal here, for example. Sometimes it looks a bit more diurnal So there's obviously a mixture of the two frequencies going on here, but it's mostly semi-diurnal. Then we go to Manila in the Philippines, and it's another mixture, but the diurnal frequency is dominating here. You've got a few semi-diurnal signatures where the tidal amplitude is a bit lower here, but when you have the high tides, it's diurnal. And then Vietnam. In Vietnam, you have a very clear diurnal tide. Not necessarily for the reasons I was explaining earlier, just to do with latitude. It's also to do with the size of the basin, how long it takes a Kelvin wave to go around. That's what picks out these different frequencies, right? Traditionally, tidal science is just a question of analyzing a whole bunch of different frequencies, right? And they give them names, right? So the lunar semi-diurnal tide is called the M2 tide. The solar semi-diurnal tide is called the S2 tide. That sort of makes sense. And then it gets a bit more complicated after that. But basically, we have the period of the, for example, the solar semi-diurnal tide, 12 hours. That's the average period, right? The moon, that's 12.42 hours, so 12 hours and 25 minutes. Yeah? The amplitude, well, we call it 100 for the moon. That's just by definition. And then the sun, it's 46.6, so it's about half as strong as the lunar tide. And then you have all these other components which have different amplitudes, different periods, semi-diurnal, diurnal, and longer periods. And they all have letters and names and tidal models take into account all these components. I'm going to show you a couple of components. So here are maps of amplitude around Europe, in the North Atlantic here, of the M2 tide, the S2 tide, a couple of other semi-diurnal components. And what do you reckon? So lunar tide, solar tide, they're all semi-diurnal, and they all look the same, right? They all look fairly similar. It's not surprising, because what we have here is the response of a dynamical system to forcing at a particular frequency, right? So the system doesn't care which astronomical object is doing the forcing, right? It's just going to respond in the same way. But then if you look at the diurnal tide, it looks they all look the same as well, but they look different to these ones, right? So there you go. That's the amplitude pattern for the tides. And we'll go back to this picture that I showed you when I was talking about Kelvin waves. If you look at the tidal range, southern England, it's just a few meters. Northern France, it's up to 10 meters, right? So the tide is stronger in northern France than it is in southern England, because it's a Kelvin wave propagating with France to its right as it goes through the English Channel, right? And here's a picture of that power station in Saint-Malo, where they generate energy from the tidal daily variations. Okay. And I think that is the end of the course. So I think that if you like the course, then everybody should give me like a like, a little thumbs up, all right? All right, give me a thumbs up, everybody. All right.